So in the next 15 minutes, we are going to see some of the intelligent things we can do with Excel. I'm sure all of you use Excel, but I hope you will be able to gain something from what I'm showing you. If you have any questions, please post them. In your attendee screen, there is an icon on top where you can post questions. And if it's a very specific question, mention the slide number as well. You can also use this area for feedback. This is a quick introduction of what I do. Probably many of you already know me, so I'm not going to read it out. As you know, we are conducting a series of 15 webcasts for individual products in the Office 365 suite. Today is the fourth webcast, and we are going to focus on Excel. As you know, I focus on inefficiency and how to eliminate it from across the world. There are two types of inefficiency when it comes to Excel. One is the operational one and one is analytical one. As we go along, you will understand more about it. Let's focus on the operational part of efficiency. Operational means if I'm doing something in X amount of time, I could have done it in much lesser time. That's inefficiency in very simple terms. So here is the first thing. This is a very simple Excel sheet. I have some data here. That data has some depending things like formula, a chart, and a pivot table. Very simple. The problem is when I add data next month, so I added one more row here, my job is done. But actually my job is not yet finished because Excel expects you to go to each formula, remember where it is, and update it. Same problem with charts and pivot tables. You have to keep updating those guys, which is an extra kind of work. And when that kind of thing happens, you are wasting time, but we can't really avoid that because unless you do it, nothing is going to work. So you're stuck. Now, this is the time you're supposed to say, that is not my job. This is Excel's job. So how do you make Excel do its job so that you can do your job more effectively? And that is done by creating a table. I'll tell you how to create a table. So same data, I created a table. And now when I add a new row, notice the formula changed and the chart also changed. In fact, if I add one more row at the bottom or even on the right side column, it will still update. You'll notice the pivot table is not changing because that requires you to right click there and say refresh, because that's the way pivot table is designed. So now we are already a little more efficient with Excel. How did this happen? Because of tables. So how do you use tables? Whenever there is raw data, go to insert menu and add a table. As soon as you add a table, you will see a separate menu called table design. And in that, another good thing to do immediately is to go to table name and change it. Excel will give table names like table 1, table 2, table 3. We change it to something more legible. That's something you can do. Having done that, now what are the benefits of tables? This is not a demo, so I'm not going to show you details of how tables are useful, but there are lots of benefits. And later on, I'll give you a link to 13 articles I have written about how to use tables more effectively. Basically, by using tables, it completely revolutionizes the way you work. Effectiveness increases, time wastage goes down, and accuracy also increases. Now let's come back to the analysis part. Analysis typically has three steps. You have to get the data from somewhere and then clean it up because typically it's not exactly correctly formatted. And then, of course, we analyze it. Needless to say, purely from a business point of view, analysis is important. But unfortunately, we end up spending too much time on the cleanup, which itself is inefficient. So how to do that cleanup faster and smarter so that we can analyze data in more detail? That's the idea. Now, when we say clean data, exactly what are you doing? If I give the same data to everyone and ask you to clean it up, you will clean it, but everyone's clean data itself will not match because the problem is there is no standardization of exactly what clean data means. So let's solve that problem. Take your time. this, you have to read one item at a time. This is a checklist. Right now, there are 10 items. 11th, I'll tell you later. So when you look at data, this is import input data. You have to look at each item and say, is this OK? Is this OK? It's a checklist. Whatever is not OK needs to be repaired. And if you follow this standard, then everyone's clean data will look same. That's the idea. So go through it. If you don't understand any of them, put it as questions. I will address them later. I'm going to pause here for a while so that you have time to read. All right. So now the process is, once you get the data, check for these 10 issues, then clean it up. And then once the data is clean, create a table. Now, you'll notice that earlier I told 11 items, but I showed only 10. The 11th is here. Assume your data is now clean by applying those 10 principles, but you get 3 pieces of that data. Then naturally, we either keep them in separate files or separate sheets. That's the 11th problem. What you should do is, keeping it like this separately is not a good idea, because even though the data came in 3 pieces, sooner or later you will have to have a consolidated report across north, south, west in this case, or across months or products or whatever pieces you have got. So what is the idea? Whatever you put as a sheet name cannot be analyzed, but whatever you put as a column can be analyzed. So that's all. You append the data one below another, and in order not to lose track of the region, add the region as a column. So that is the 11th rule for clean data. Just think about it. It takes some time to imbibe it, and then once you start using it in your day to day work, you'll realize how powerful these concepts are. Now, how to clean up? We don't have detailed time for explaining and giving demos, but there is one very important concept you need to understand. Most of us have 2 approaches. Either do it manually, or if you are a slightly evolved user, then you will probably write a macro. What most of us have not realized is Microsoft has invested a lot of time and energy in giving you a new tool, which is called Get and Transform. Earlier, we used to have Get External Data. That has now been replaced with Get and Transform. This will be available to you 2016 onwards. This is not just adding new data sources, it's complete revolution in the way we clean up data. If you don't see Get and Transform in your data menu, that means you are using an older version of Excel, in which case you'll have to download Power Query Add-in, and you will get a separate menu or a tab for that. The features are same. What does this give you? It gives you 100 different data sources, and that keeps on adding. It allows you to import data in a completely different way. Today in Excel, we import the whole thing and then clean it up, which makes it slow and file sizes grow. Here, it doesn't matter how big the data is. It takes a sample of 200 rows, gives you that sample, and then you clean up the sample first, and the real import happens as the last step. This itself saves you enormous amount of time. What can we do in the cleanup? There are hundreds of different features. None of them require programming. Some of them, which are common, are consolidating multiple files from a web page, for example, or copy pasting. Instead of copy pasting web tables and cleaning it up, directly import it from a web page. Or there are 100 other different data sources. The important part is, first time you clean up, second time, assuming the data source is same, you just say refresh. Remember, in today's world, every time, every month, when you get new data, you are wasting time cleaning again and again. Even that part gets eliminated with Power Query. So one quick little example here. This is a very common kind of data. This is called a cross tab because there is a row heading and a column heading. This is bad data or unclean data by our definition. Why? Because each column should have a heading, but the column heading should not contain data, and that's the problem here. Jan, Feb, March are sitting in the place where the heading should be. Yes, but they are data. Ideally, I need 3 columns: product, month, and whatever the value is. Also remember the last rule was data should not grow horizontally. In this format for May and June, I have to add more columns. That means it's growing horizontally. So even that way it is wrong. Now the question is, how do I do this? Remember, you'll have to do one row at a time, copy paste special transpose, which is obviously inefficient. So here is the new way of doing this. Remember, this looks like output of a pivot table where products are in row, months are in column, and whatever data is in the value area. We want to unpivot it. How do you do it? Select the data, create a table, then go to get and transform data, say table or range. Now it opens Power Query, which is the powerful data cleanup engine. And now you select the bad columns, then right click and choose this very powerful feature called unpivot columns. And in one click, it will do the job of multiple row, manual, unpivot or copy paste transpose. Of course, you have to rename the attribute and value columns because Power Query doesn't know what the data is. And then you get the data cleaned up in very few steps. Next time, assuming the raw data changes a little, you just say refresh and the job will repeat. So the other problem with Excel, which I'm sure all of you face at some point of time, is if the data grows, then Excel slows down. That is because Excel was never designed to be a database. We use it like a database. So Microsoft solved that problem in 2010, that's 10 years back, by adding a database inside Excel, which is called data model. You should see Power Pivot menu. If you don't see it, you have older version, you can install Power Pivot add-in. The idea is if the data is large, don't import it in Excel, put it in the data model. Now the question is, how do I do it? So let me show you how that is done. So when you go to data model, what are the benefits? First of all, the 1 million row limit goes away. You can have any number of millions as long as you have a good machine. It is very fast. It compresses data very well, and it gives you many more functions, which is called DAX, which eliminate a lot of manual formulas. Finally, you can still create pivot tables as usual. The question is, how do I put data directly into data model instead of importing it in Excel? So you already saw get and transform, which is the import part. In Power Query, there is an option called close and load to. When you do that, just say create only a connection and add to data model. So nothing comes to Excel sheet, data goes to data model, and then pivot table understands there is a data model. So you can still create pivot tables and charts exactly the way you are doing earlier. So nothing is lost, but all the benefits of large data handling. Now let's come to analytical inefficiency. What do I mean by that? So let me give you a quick example. This is some sample data. I have, let's say, a lot of rows, a lot of columns, 11 columns, 1500 rows. How many reports will you create? The typical answer is depends on what boss asks. It could be boss, government, regulator, whoever. If someone asks a report, we create it. If nobody asks, we don't create it. So in any given situation, finite number of reports are created, and that is the analytical inefficiency. Why am I saying that? Because what really is analytics? You have to learn something from the historical data. What do you have to learn? Useful things from the past data. Use that knowledge to try and improve the future. That's the concept of analytics. But if you say I make 7 reports, then we are learning 7 things. If you say 12 reports, 12 things. The problem is data never told you there are 7 or 8 useful things. There could be an equally useful 9th or 10th or 27th is useful thing. You're not looking at it. That's a loss of opportunity. If you're looking at it, that's a business opportunity. That's the way it is. So the idea is there is a gap here. We are looking at few useful things. The ideal thing is to learn all possible useful things from the data. So at least conceptually we are on the right track, but practically, how many reports will you create? There's not enough time to create unlimited reports. So that problem has been very intelligently solved using AI by Microsoft. There is a button called Ideas in Excel, new version required. If you don't have this button, then go to Excel online. Just put the file on OneDrive or Teams and open it. You will see this button. Once you click on that button for the same data, what it does is it analyzes the data using AI. You don't have to tell Excel what reports you want. Excel will tell you what reports are worth looking at. It's a game changer. So I did that with the same data. Notice what it is showing me. It's giving me a few reports and saying I have created 36 reports. Would you like to look at it? Please look at them. What is it doing? It's showing you trends, it's showing you maximums, it's showing you frequency distributions and many, many other things. Now, why is it calculating so many reports? You never asked. Because let's take one report and think. What is it saying? It is saying in the city of Gwalior, amount is decreasing with date. This is a decreasing trend it found. There are 85 cities. It analyzed all 85 and it found decreasing trend, which is statistically significant only in one of them. That's why it is showing you this. Similarly, it's saying in the year, in the month of Jan, there is cashback increasing trend, because that means in the remaining 11 months, there is nothing statistically significant. So when you find something useful, for example, an outlier here, why is this report important? Because this is at date level. Typically in pivot table, you will never have date level reports. You'll have month or quarter or year. Now I'm interested in finding out these abnormal transactions. Now you can say insert pivot chart. It inserts a new pivot table and a chart automatically, and then you can investigate. That is what I mean by learn all possible useful things. Always click on the ideas button. And remember to click on the button next month when the data is appended or changed. Going one step further, it also gives you a English language Q&A. So you ask, Excel answers. So notice I've asked average cashback monthly. I didn't have to put a formula. I did not have to create a pivot. If I want, it will give me the pivot. Another one, higher stage for fuel and silver. So fuel is a different column, expense type. Silver is a different column called card type. I did not mention the field name at all, but still it has expanded it properly and it is giving me the answer. So like that, you ask questions and Excel gives you the answer. Depending on the kind of answer, you can either insert a pivot table or just insert it as a table. So this is great. Start using it. Finally, Office app. There is an Excel app, but now recently, a week or one month back, I think, Microsoft introduced a combined Office app, which has a brilliant feature for Excel. So we have Excel app as a part of Office. Install this from Play Store or iPhone Store. Then there are actions. So one of the actions which is relevant for today is image to table. So what happens? I'm just taking a photograph of something which is sort of a table. Then you click on it, choose the area of the table, and then it allows you to edit if there are any mistakes, and then you say open in Excel and the data goes into Excel. So this is a very quick, smart AI based recognition way of converting pictures to data. This can be very useful for data entry and eliminate a lot of time and energy, which today goes in looking at receipts and paper based inputs and putting them in Excel. So to summarize, we saw a few nice, useful, immediately usable things in Excel. I hope you like them. If required, we can do a more detailed session later based on your feedback. Finally, a bonus. Based on whatever I've said and I have been teaching for decades, I have a list of a sort of a thought process of Excel data analysis best practices. I will give you download instructions of where to do it from later. This will be a PDF file you can download and use. Finally, we continue this live streaming sessions. Tomorrow is PowerPoint, so please take note. It's 7 p.m. in the night, India time. And of course, I'll be posting the links very soon. Finally, where are the videos of all these sessions? This is the link, or you can go to my Efficiency 365 channel on YouTube and search. You will find this link. And today's video will be available in another 2 hours on the same. This is a playlist, so all the videos will get added there. And whatever links or references I mentioned will also be there in that video description. So that is all the time we have. Thank you and be safe. And now we can take questions. So before we take questions, let me thank Anindo for helping me set up this and be with me for the entire series. Thanks, Anindo. So how is it going? Any questions?
Quite a few questions. You're welcome, Nitin.
Yeah, Let me go to the Q&A panel. OK, I'm only looking at published ones right now, so if there is anything unpublished, please do it. I'll start from the top, right?
Yeah, everything is published. Just start from the top.
OK, one question is, how did you put Excel in PPT? Oh, that's just a screenshot, so nothing special there, just copy paste. Please rule 11. Explain rule 11 again. Okay, fair enough. Let me do that.
Jairam has tried to explain rule 11 to Prashant in the next published.
Yeah, saw that. So let me just jump to rule 11. So what I'm trying to explain is, if you have clean data, you already have applied those 10 rules as we talked about. And if you already have clean data, then let's say I got one piece of clean data, second piece of clean data, third piece of clean data. Individually, they're good. But now if I end up putting them in three separate sheets, they are three different pieces of data. And now if you at any point of time want to combine them, you'll have to struggle. So before that struggle happens, when you get multiple pieces of clean data which are related to each other, in this case, data is similar, but from different regions. In another case, it would be same context, but monthly data. Whatever that is, what you put as sheet names, you put as an extra column name. That is the whole idea, because sheet names cannot be analyzed, but column names can be analyzed. That's the 11th rule. So if you're making a monthly report, every month you're getting a file, saving it as Jan report, Feb report, month, May report, whatever. Eventually you're going to require to create a consolidated yearly report, or maybe across years. So keep adding the data in the same sheet and add the month and year as columns so that you don't lose track. So you can create one pivot table, filter it on a month for monthly report, remove the filter for consolidation. Don't worry about number of rows, because we have already handled how to manage large data. All right, so now let's go here. Let me see other questions. So Jairam, thanks for answering. Please explain point 9 and 10 of cleanup slide. OK, let's go to 9 and 10. So data must grow vertically. I have already mentioned, because I showed you data which was Jan, Feb, March in each column. And for May, June, we will be keeping on adding columns. That's called data growing vertically. Data should grow vertically. Data should not grow horizontally. So what I showed earlier, let me show you that slide just for recap so that it's properly endorsed. This is the slide. So what was I trying to show you? This data is bad because in April, May, June, we are going to add more columns, so it's going to grow horizontally. If you combine or unpivot it properly, this data, which is product, month and value, will continue to grow vertically irrespective of how many products and how many months. That's the idea. Now to answer your other question, I will have to show you an Excel file. So let me see if I can show you that. So the other question was 9. Formatting should not include meaning, so it may take a few seconds for it to refresh, but just bear with me. Item 9 was formatting and meaning are two different things. So let me bring that one here. No formatting instead of data itself. What does that really mean? Let me explain. So here what we have is just two columns, and I have some cells which are in yellow, some cell is in red. This is formatting. This is not meaning. Why? Because the meaning is not written anywhere. If it is not written anywhere, we can't analyze it. Yes, the person who added that yellow or red color will know what yellow red means, but for how long? Tomorrow, I'm going to use the same yellow color in another Excel sheet for a completely different meaning. So across time, I'm also going to forget. Bottom line, even if you remember what is yellow and red, the problem is, can you get a total of yellow or average of yellow? You can't. There is no sum of color. So bottom line is, when you want meaning, you need a column. So this means anything to be analyzed, there is no substitute for a column. If you still like colors, no problem. You can use conditional formatting, but you are still using the data first and then doing the formatting. That's the concept. OK, let me move to the other questions. Can we do data joins like outer inner join? Absolutely. If you have two pieces of data with a primary key, foreign key, you can do all kinds of joins, including left and right anti joins, which are very useful to see which data is in this piece and not there, and vice versa. Absolutely. Information on ideas creating is very useful. Thank you. Can we get the PPT or video for further reference? Absolutely. I have already given you the reference. Let me show you that reference again, just to be clear. So all the videos will be available here. All the videos will be available in this bit.ly/coronaddpl. This is a YouTube playlist. Last three videos already there, and this will also be added very soon. All right. Lovely session. We'll love to have it longer session. OK, let's see how it goes. Let me finish this series and I'm sure we can do something about it. Rahul Desai is saying, in case of large number of cells, Excel converts them into exponential something. Yes, those are not brought back, correct? So if you want large numbers and you want to manage them more like text than numbers, then you have to change the data format to text, and that can be much more easily done in Power Query than in regular Excel. In regular Excel, you'll have to put an apostrophe, because the moment it converts it to exponential, it's not going to keep the precision. All right. Yeah, I can share the presentation as well. I'll put that in description. Chinmay Patil, hi man, how are you? I have to take column data and unpivot it to use, but data is growing column wise every day. No problem. Then you choose the good column, right click and say unpivot other columns. That'll work. Information is useful. Please explain more about ideas. OK, very quickly I'll try to do that. So what happens in ideas is this. Let me show you, if possible, live. So this is some data. Let me go to my data tab. My mouse cursor is really big, so it's a little difficult for me. Just bear with me. So once you have the data, what you do is, assuming you have the new version of Excel, go to the Home tab. You will see an Ideas button. Click on that. This requires an internet connection because your data is getting encrypted, going to Microsoft AI algorithm and then coming back. So it analyzes all combinations of your data. And it gives you reports. Earlier it gave me 36, now it's giving me 37. It varies a little. Now what is the idea? You look at all these and figure out which ones are interesting enough for you. The reason being, we are used to creating standard reports. There may be something non-standard but equally useful. So this is the way to analyze all possible useful things from the data. So any piece of data you have, first finish all your standard reporting, but analysis doesn't stop there. Continue it with the ideas. If you don't see ideas button, upload the file to OneDrive, open it on browser, you will see it. Last bonus point, download link. I'll put it. I have not created the link yet. I'll put it in description of the video. Sensitivity command is a long topic. I'm sorry, I can't do it right now, but probably in the detailed session. Okay, Chinmay is asking, I unpivot this in Tableau, but have to unpivot it manually every day. Yeah, correct. So that's why in Power BI there is unpivot other columns option. Where is the video available? I have already answered. Information useful. Yes, YouTube channel link I have already shown. Let me anyway go to that while I'm answering questions. All right, what are the pros and cons if we use Excel in Teams as a tab? Will these pivot work there also? So remember, in Teams, whenever Word, Excel, PowerPoint opens, it's like opening on a browser, exactly the same feature as Excel online. So whatever features Excel online has, they will work, but obviously full version of Excel has many more features. So that's the limitation. Pivot table can be created. Pivot table can be created, no problem, but it cannot be fully functional in terms of all the features, but pivot table analysis in terms of changing filters and stuff, yes, some of it is available on browser as well. Can I attend an in-depth Excel course? So yes, good, you reminded me. So let me actually try to give you the link. Just give me a second till I open my LinkedIn. So I have done a course on Udemy on pivot table. I have made it free for a few days. Today is the last day, I think. I don't remember the exact one, but let me just show you that. You can note down that link as well. So this is the link. bit.ly coronapv2. If you go here, you will see a detailed course on pivot tables. This is free. This is 5 hours of video with sample files and all that. OK, data should grow vertically, but normally daily wise data go whole month. Yes, so let data be entered horizontally. When it comes to analysis, do an unpivot and then you have best of both worlds. The important thing is when you unpivot the data, it does not change the original. Whatever you do in Power Query, it does not change the original data, which is a great thing. Because what happens? Your data entry is still happening with horizontal growth. No problem. Make sure it's a table at least. Otherwise it's not going to work, and then unpivot it. And then when the raw data changes, more columns get added there. Go to your output data and say refresh. So that gives you best of both worlds. Yes, Mehul is saying superb webinar. Can we attend in depth? Yes, we will plan something. Anti-join, please explain how to use and why to use. So a little difficult because it'll take a little more time, but I'll give you the use case. Many times we have one piece of data and another piece of data. The columns are same. There is same customer ID, product ID, something like that. Now this data came from somewhere, this data came from somewhere. Now I want to know in data A, which are the rows which are not there in data B and vice versa. So what you do is you import both data pieces in Power Query and then say join them. But if you join them, they will get combined. We don't want to combine them. We anti-join means what is not here and there, give me a piece. What is here but not there, give me a piece, and then you combine them. So that is called anti-join. So typically bank reconciliation kind of thing, or you got one list of attendees from one vendor, another list of attendees which was in-house, like that. So some cards were common, those kind of things. Thanks for the session, worth the time. Thank you. Helpful sessions. When can we attend your in-person training program? I don't do public training programs, but I'm sure when coronavirus is gone, we will plan something. XLookup demo, probably not now because it's a different concept and it'll take time, but maybe in the detailed webinar. All right, any more questions? That's good, we had 29 questions. So any more questions coming? I'll wait for a few minutes, a few seconds rather, and then otherwise we'll call it a night. Anindo, any questions which I have not answered? Yes, Anindo. Shesham.
There's one which has just got added. Where do we get short keys?
Where do you get short keys? Okay, so I'm assuming he's talking about shortcuts. So of course, there, if you go to help file, and there are thousands of websites which will give you shortcuts, but that's not an efficient way of doing it. If you go to my blog, there is an article on which keyboard shortcuts I need. So read that article. I'm just going to show you that article right now. You don't need to really worry about the link of this article. Just go to my blog and search for which keyboard shortcuts. So there's an article on how to learn keyboard shortcuts. There are hundreds of them. You don't need to learn all of them. You need to learn which ones you need. That's the idea.
We have one more question. Can we connect database SQL as data model?
Yes, absolutely. You can connect SQL as data model. So I was consciously avoiding demos in this, but now in Q&A, I can actually show you. If I go to data, get data, look at where I can get data from. All kinds of files, CSV, Excel is common. Another interesting one called folder, where you have a folder with 200 CSV files, that also works fine. A folder with 200 Excel files, that also works fine. The requirement in both cases is columns must be constant and data types must be constant. And in case of Excel, the data must be in a table and the table must have the same name. Now, if you go to database, you will notice there are all the common kind of databases. Many of you must be using SAP HANA. That also works fine. And if you use Power BI, then even Salesforce is available. If you have data for LOB applications on Azure, then all the Azure data sources also work. Then there are lots of online services. Here is Salesforce, Dynamics, SharePoint as well. Some of you have data in SharePoint, and a long list of other data sources as well, including Hadoop. And least common denominator, you have some weird on-premise data source which has no special stuff, no data, nothing. Then at least it will have an ODBC or OLTP driver. So that's how all kinds of data can be connected here. And if any of you are developers and you have really, really proprietary kind of data and you want to integrate it with Power BI, there is an SDK which allows you to create connectors for Power BI. So that's the answer.
There's another question. Do you have Power BI e-learning module available?
I do have a Power BI e-learning module available, but the prerequisite to learn that is to learn pivot table first. That's why I have made the pivot table course free as of now. I will make the Power BI course free after a few days after you have gone through this. Many people jump to Power BI because it's fashionable. Nothing wrong with that, but if you have some unresolved concepts or bad habits in Excel, they translate to Power BI. And other problem is you should know where to use Excel, where to use Power BI. So because we don't know Excel fully, things which can be done better in Excel, we try to do in Power BI and it doesn't work. Same concept applies to all BI tools, in fact. That's why I recommend that you learn pivot table and data analysis in Excel first, and then you know exactly how to address Power BI. Pivot tips are very useful for project managers and PMO executives globally. Thank you. Thanks for the feedback. All right. So any more questions? Otherwise we'll close. It's good. We still have 43 people attending, which indicates Excel is popular. And it also indicates people are noticing their inefficiency. So on my blog, there are, I think it's 200 articles on Excel. Everything I have mentioned plus more, with greater detail, sample files, more discussion and thoughts is there. So please go there and share it as well. So Anindo, shall we close for the day?
Yeah, Nitin, I think we might as well. Otherwise, we'll probably go on all night. So yeah, I think this was good.
Yeah. So thanks, Anindo. Thanks, Shesham and Zeus. see you guys tomorrow. I will be posting the links very soon, and make sure you share it with as many people as possible. Thank you. Bye bye. Take care.